Hello and good evening from Bayswater in London, from St. Mary the Angels. And tonight we're going to do another prayer meeting with a couple of Christmas songs. It's Advent and it's nice to get into the mood for Christmas. It's nice to get the Holy Spirit involved and the spirit of Christmas. And yes, it's a season of joy, goodwill, hope and peace. So let the Holy Spirit come now. Come, Holy Spirit, to send your peace on us. Come, Holy Spirit, Comforter. Give us blissful Christmas spirit, renewal, advent, change, conversion, transformation. Come, Holy Spirit, come, Holy Spirit, come, Holy Spirit. And I think you all know this hymn that I'm going to begin with because I have a nice presence of Jesus and Our Lady and the saints with us and all the angels, and we're coming from St. Mary of the Angels, so this church is very special. So we have all the angels, all the saints in heaven, and Our Lady and Jesus and the Divine Trinity with us, so praise be Jesus. Just going to clear my throat. Silent night.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin, mother and child, holy hymn. So tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin, mother and child, holy infant, so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. It's always nice to begin with a nice, gentle hymn that is very powerful. And welcome to my prayer meeting. And I'm just praying and praising and helping us settle into the spirit of Advent, the spirit of Christmas, prepare our hearts for the coming of Jesus. And Jesus is the Saviour. He is the one who came into the world to save us from sin. And his name is Emmanuel. God is with us. How beautiful is the story of Christmas? How beautiful is it that God became flesh? The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. How that's why Christianity appeals to me, because God became human in the form of man and humbled himself and dwelt among us to be with us. How beautiful is that? There's no other religion that speaks that volume of love, and that's why it speaks to me on so many volumes, so many mysteries, and it's a beautiful thing to ponder. And God's love is beyond us. It's beyond all our understanding. We only can comprehend what Jesus is, what God is, but we have glimpses of it when we pray. We have glimpses of it at Christmas. We have glimpses of it at Easter and all these special celebrations that the church gives us. So let's see what I'm going to sing next. Let's see if I can get a song. Come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit. Come Holy Spirit, come. Come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit, come Holy Spirit. Well, this isn't a Christmas hymn, but it's a nice song. So bear with me. So the technology loads. It's a bit slow this evening, but I hope everyone is well. So please, Jesus, come into our hearts, prepare our hearts. Our Lady, come and help us prepare our hearts and make them like your stable, the stable that Jesus was born in. Help us, Our Lady, to empty our hearts out of bitterness, unforgiveness, resentment, worldliness. So Jesus, let's come in the spirit of Christmas. This is Thank God I Do. I've seen love come and I've seen love walk away. So many questions. Will anybody stay? It's been a hard year. So many nights tears, all of the darkness trying to fight my fears. Alone, so long, alone. I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. I'd probably fall off the edge. Go if I ever let go, so keep me held in your hands. Praise you, Jesus. What would we do without you, God? You are everything. Praise you, God. Blessed be God. I've started breathing. The weight is lifted here with you, it's easy. My head is finally clear. There's nothing missing when you are by my side. I took the long road, but now I realize I'm home. With you, I'm home. I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. I'd probably fall off the edge. I don't know where I'd go if I ever let go. So keep me held in your hands. I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. I'd probably fall off the edge. I don't know where I'd go if you ever let go. So keep me held in your hand. You're my safe place, my hideaway. You're my anchor, my saving grace. You're my constant, my steadiness. You're my shelter, my oxygen.
I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. Thank God I do. I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. I'd probably fall off the edge. I don't know where I'd go if you ever let go. So keep me held in your hand. I don't know who I'd be if I didn't know you. Thank God I do.
Praise you, Jesus. Well, it's always nice to begin with a few songs. And we should praise God because my life was in the bad. This is a mind of its own. Bear with me a second.
Their business version was,
you know, I had a hard life when I was growing up, bullied, all those things. God was never there. He was, but I didn't notice and I didn't pray. And then one day, through a nervous breakdown, through taking too much drugs, I had an experience of Our Lady, and she led me straight to Jesus. And she's very powerful in these times, and she wants to lead us to Jesus. She is so motherly, she is so caring, and she can do more for us than our earthly mothers. And she just wants us to know Jesus, to love Jesus. And when we have Jesus in our lives, we are truly centered. We are truly content. Our hearts are at rest, and nothing that the world can distract us from, all these material things, bye, rat race. God and Our Lady and the saints and the angels long for us to be with Jesus because he's our savior. And when our hearts rest in Jesus, they rest, and they are rest. They're not restless. They rest, and we don't go searching for voids to fill our hearts when we have the thing that will fill our every void, and that's Jesus. And that's the importance of Jesus. That's the treasure of Jesus. And Christmas always reminds us of the treasure of Jesus, because he was born in a stable, poor, into poverty, and that's where the treasure is. Jesus was born into poverty to show us the riches of the church, the riches of the sacraments, and the riches of Jesus. Amen. So, bear with me a second, I just need to turn this off. It's got a mind of its own, I swear. Okay. It's got a mind of its own. So, I was praying earlier, and I was in adoration, and Jesus was very much around me, and when I pray to Jesus and I feel Jesus and he speaks to me, his presence overwhelms me and I'm filled with joy, filled with peace, filled with supernatural light, filled with supernatural love. And he's so firm, yet merciful and loving. And sometimes he speaks prophetically and he gives me very uncomfortable messages, especially about the future and the times we're in. But he always emphasizes on hope. He doesn't come to breed fear. Fear comes from the devil. But God and Jesus want to warn us and educate us on the times that we're in. Because the times have got so evil and there's a lot of darkness. So Jesus comes to bear light, and Jesus comes to make everything that is hidden transparent and brought into the light. So that's basically what he does. And there's no need to be afraid. Fear comes from the devil. Hope, love, serenity, peace and joy come from God. And when we have God, when we have a deep prayer life, nothing can take away our peace or our tranquility or our serenity or contentment. And that's what Jesus is trying to teach us, and Our Lady teaches us in these times. If we prepare our hearts for Advent, if we prepare our hearts for Jesus, if we treat our heart like a stable and get rid of the damp, dark crevices and allow God to illuminate them and hand them over, then our stable becomes a place that's welcoming for Jesus. And then we can be transformed. And then the more we give over to Jesus, the more we repent, the more we look at ourselves and admit that we're sinners and that we're, but we have evil inside us, then God wants to free us from that evil. It's not from, that's not our true selves, and that makes us holy, wholesome. And that's what God's teaching us. And confession isn't a way of, oh, I'm a sinner, I'm going to hell, I condemn myself. No, you go to confession because Jesus wants to take away the gunk and the dirt and the filth, and he wants to give you a shower in his precious blood, and he wants to transform you. So when you go to confession, your soul gets cleaned. You take a shower every week. So why not go to confession weekly or monthly, and you will see the transformation from the inside, and it shines through the outside. I just had a confession tonight, and I was talking to the priest, and I ended up crying after it because it released so much darkness and so much weight. And when I went to confession, I was cleansed and made new, and I was happy and joyful and serene. And that's what God wants to do. God doesn't want us to be having a pity party. And that's when we have a pity party, we invite Satan and all the demons come, and are they happy whenever we're downtrodden. But God wants us to repent and admit our weakness so God can come and be our strength. That is what it is. And confession is reconciliation. It's reconciling with Jesus. And it's putting things right with Jesus so he can work with us, and he can transform us, and he can take away all those dark things in our hearts and the darkness of sin that weighs us down and makes us depressed. Then we become transparent light bearers, and we become filled with more Holy Spirit, become filled with more grace, and then we can radiate. That's basically what he wants us to do. And that's it in a nutshell. Okay, now I'm going to read what Jesus said to me earlier in prayer. So I'm just going to get it now. So Jesus spoke to me during adoration, and he said, the world is about to change. Solar flares and storms will disrupt technology and communications, as well as more frequent volcanic eruptions and earthquakes due to tectonic faults caused by these solar storms and flares. My justice is about to fall on the earth. Many signs will be visible from the heavens as a warning. My terrible day of the Lord, as predicted in Scripture, is fast approaching. Two comets will collide, causing the sky to roll up like a scroll. Then all will become dark, and my cross will illuminate the sky, and it will in turn illuminate your souls and consciences. My Father will come to judge and converse with every one of you above the age of reason. You will see all of your sinfulness and the good that you neglected to do. You will see the extent and damage each of your sins did to one another, as well as the damage to yourselves and the environment. Today, the weather and nature is rebelling against you, humankind, because your sins have multiplied and many of you neglect to repent and come to me in the sacrament of reconciliation. This wicked generation has been deceived by Satan into thinking that sin does not exist, nor does the devil. I am warning you, my brethren, that sin has multiplied so much that soon there will be no pardoning, as my justice will come, and those insubordinate souls that refuse my mercy must walk through my terrible justice. Do not be afraid, my remnant. My mercy has followed you and seeks you out. Your liberation is at hand after the terrible and short tribulation of my people and my church. This is your passion, but in the end, my Eucharistic and true reign as Prince of Peace will come. And there will be a new springtime, and my kingdom will come and be revived like never before. Hold on to this promise of hope. I send you my legions of angels in these times, with many, many prophets, messengers, and my mother, who will manifest very powerfully to bring you all over the threshold to enter into my peace that the world cannot give or secure you. Hold on to hope. I do not come to frighten you. I come in peace to prepare and forewarn you. Shalom. So, okay, let's dissect this. So Jesus is telling us that in the future, there's going to be a lot more earthquakes, a lot more volcanic eruptions, a lot more natural disasters. And these are all caused by sin. Because when man comes up from nature, we're all made from the cosmos and we're all connected to the earth. And when man is not in harmony with himself and each other through sin and wars and hatred and bitterness, etc., then the environment that man lives in is not healthy. So nature is rebelling against us because there's an imbalance in man. So then, therefore, there is an imbalance in nature because sins are multiplied and multiplied, and then very few people are confessing and repenting. So the sin is able to destroy and attach and attack like a cancer in the environment and through people. It's terrible. Sin is real. And Jesus has emphasized this, and I can't sugarcoat this, but he's saying, if we take stock and stop and think and look at the world, nature is trying to warn us and say, look, you're going too far without God. You're pushing God away. You don't believe in the devil, that he exists. You don't believe in demons, evil spirits. You don't believe in sin. And therefore, there's consequences of not believing and pushing God out. And God's using this as a catalyst to show us, look, you've messed up, but I'm merciful. I'm still coming, and I'm using prophets and messengers and people to tell you to turn back and stop what you're doing because you're going to destroy yourselves and destroy your environment. He's coming from mercy. And he's also talking about the future when two comets will collide and the sky will roll up like a scroll. And this is the day of the Lord. This is the illumination of conscience. And many mystics like Padre Pio, Saint Faustina have all predicted this. So many prophets before us, even Daniel speaks of this and other prophets. And it's called the day of the Lord. Even the apostles that wrote the Gospels prophesied this. So it's even in scripture. And this day will come. And it's not a thing to be afraid of because it's God's going to give us a mini judgment. He's going to come and he's going to pause time, and everyone in the world, whether they're Jew, Hindu, Buddhist, Muslim, whatever creed, nationality or race or religion or sexuality or gender, they're all going to have a mini judgment. God is going to illuminate our souls with a cross in the sky to show that Jesus came and died for our sins. And that cross is going to illuminate our souls and our consciences. And we are going to see the good we could have done, the good we didn't do, and all the sins we committed in our life, and the damage they did to ourselves, the damage they did to the people around us and the environment and nature. And then we have a chance to turn back from our wicked ways and assess where our lives are going. Because at that moment, we will know if our soul is destined for purgatory, heaven or hell. And this is the reality. There is a such thing as hell, there's a such thing as purgatory, and there's a such thing as heaven. And these are all scripture, and I can't rewrite scripture. Jesus is teaching me a long time about heaven, hell, purgatory, and the saints and the souls in purgatory and the angels and things. And the reality of demons, it's all real. And we're in a battle between the principalities of darkness. And it's real. It's a battle for souls, and souls are at stake. And the devil wants to take all of us with him. And this world can manipulate and attach us to other things and attract us to other things. But if we really pray, and if we went to Mass every day, if we lived a sacramental life, we would see things differently. We would be awakened from our blindness. Because if we don't pray, if we don't go and receive the sacraments, we're blind. And we don't see things the way Jesus sees them. So now that I pray and I try my best to live a good life and a holy life and a pure life, I see things in a different way. I see the evil out there, and I do see the devil as the prince of this world for now. And he is so clever, conniving, deceiving. He's a liar, and he tells half-truths. So he makes things attractive, and he makes sin attractive, and he makes sin easy to commit. If you even turn on the TV now and go on to pop music, all the music videos have women half naked with dollar bills and sex glamorized, you know? And that's not right, because you know, promiscuity is wrong. And God is trying to say, look, the world's going this way. And a lot of pop stars have sold their souls. And a lot of pop stars are coming out now and saying that a fella from Boyzone recently, who's Christian, said he used to see people in the pop industry, like the big names, like the record producers, praying over the records. And they'd say demonic prayers. And Satan was the best musician in heaven before he fell. He was the greatest talented musician and singer. And God used him as his favourite talented entertainer to entertain God and the choirs. And then when Satan fell, he fell on earth. And now he's using pop stars. Because when Jesus was in the desert, the devil tempted him with all the fame, all the fortune, all the kingdoms, all the riches. And now the devil's using famous people to attract young people. Say, oh, you're only successful if you have this fashion item, this Gucci dress, this car. And they glamorize sex, they glamorize sin, they glamorize drugs and all the music videos. And this is the devil, and he's infiltrating everything. And it's only now that I pray and I see things, and all these big pop stars that you watch and go to concerts. I went and saw a Madonna concert when I was younger, and she had demons on the stage dressed in horns and everything. And it just was so dark and satanic. And now looking back, I can see Satan's reign and infiltration in the music industry, in the film industry, in the entertainment industry. And the devil was God's greatest entertainer. So the devil knows what he's doing, and he wants to manipulate souls. And he uses video games as well. And all the young kids are glued to TV. They're glued to their iPads. They're glued to everything, and they're comatose with information and technology. And they're lethargic and asleep. And the priests and the bishops don't talk about this enough. Some of them do, some of them don't. We're not educated in the church. Everyone's left on a free rein. And now we're suffering the consequences of it. There's so much depression. There's so much suicide. There's so much mental illness is through the roof. No one is going to mass. No one is praying. The devil has us all like this. You go on a train, everyone's glued to their phones. There's no communication. People don't talk. And that's important, because we need to talk things out and talk about our problems and stuff. And that's why depression's through the roof. That's why mental health is through the roof. We're in a pandemic. We're in an absolute social emergency. The world has never been so steeped in sin. The world has never been so anti-God, anti-Christian. And all these pop idols, pop stars, and all these music industries and movies, that even if you turn on a film, all you hear is Jesus Christ taken in vain. And it doesn't sit right. And God is just, you know, and I get called a freak. I get called not wise. I get called mentally ill because I believe in God. And I'm outspoken about these things. But God has given me and taught me a lot about the times we're in. And it's through this platform that he's given me a voice. And if people want to listen, that's fine. If people don't, turn off. But we are in an emergency. And God has had enough. His patience is tried. But he's still merciful. He's not coming to wipe out the world and destroy it. No. He is coming to give us a chance to turn back and turn to him. And there is people that won't, no matter what he does. And his justice has to come. And that's why. But he won't ever over-exercise his mercy. His mercy is endless. It's like an ocean. His mercy is like a deep ocean. And an ocean has no depth. His mercy has no depth. And I know God. I've got to know God. And he is so loving, so omnipotent. But he has to take charge. He has to be authoritative. Because if he doesn't, we're going to destroy the world. We're going to destroy the environment. And we're going to destroy the future of our children. And God is smart, strategic. He's patient, but he's also a just God. And things have got so out of hand that he has to rein us back in. And unfortunately, because there's so much sin in the world and so much evil, it has consequences. And when the world pushes out God, we bear the fruit of that. And the fruit of that is depression, illnesses, plagues, famines, nature rebelling, etc., etc., etc. So things are really heated up now. If you just have to look at the weather, you just have to look and turn on the news. The world is in a pandemic, an emergency. But in the end, God promises peace. An era of peace, like the way man was before Adam and Eve were tempted by Satan. They lived in the divine will and they had the illuminated light of God in them, and they didn't have sin. They didn't have death. So we're going to go back to that. Imagine one day we're all going to live in world peace like at the Garden of Eden, and that's worth fighting for. But we're going to go into a tribulation. We're going to go into a battle. A lot of people are going to be martyred. The church is going to run blood red, because that's the only way the church will be reborn, is through the blood of martyrs like it was in the early days. Because we're in a war, we're in a battle, and the devil wants to take as many souls with him as he can, and he will fight nail, tooth and comb, and he will lie and say he doesn't exist. He will lie and say that there's no such thing as sin. But of course, we have to pray for these people who have sold their souls to Satan, and these pop stars that are promised all these things and they've been deceived, and we have to like pray for them and not judge them. And that's, some Christians can jump on this bandwagon of judging them and condemn them to hell. We can't do that. We can't play God. And that's where the devil tricks us too, and he gets all people all riled up and judging. No, pray for everyone. And Jesus has even said from the cross, when he was being crucified by his own people, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. That is how forgiving Jesus is. Jesus is merciful unto the end. But people do go to hell, because even though Jesus is so merciful and he exercises his mercy until the last minute, there still are people who refuse to go to heaven. There's people that hate God that much, hate the light of God that much, that out of God's love, God had to create a place for them to go as well. Because it's not up to God who goes to hell. We put ourselves there. And there will be people that cannot stand the light of God and do not want to spend eternity with God. They would rather spend an eternity with hell, with the devil. And the hell is no God, no hope, no love. Just complete darkness and agony without God. That's what hell is. And look, we can live hell here. I lived hell on earth here because I didn't pray. I didn't know God. I didn't have God. So I was depressed. I was suicidal. I was on drugs. So having come out of that and transformed, I know the value of God. I know the value of prayer. But I can say this. A life with God is worth all the money in the world, all the cars, all the riches. Because when you have God, you have everything and you want for nothing. I gave up my whole life to do this. I had a big job. I had everything. And Jesus came to me in a vision and he asked me to give it all up. And let me tell you, I suffer and I get called a lot of names and blah, blah, blah. But I am rich and I'm free like a bird, because I'm not attached to anything this world has to offer. I'm attached to God, his love, his mercy, and his sacraments and his church. And that is where the riches are. The riches are in the church. The riches are in the sacraments. And the riches are in Jesus. So praise be God. So I hope you enjoyed that sermon. I didn't go on a bit, but I felt the Holy Spirit blasting through me. So praise you, God. And I just want everyone to have what I have. You know, what have I got to gain from talking like this? And I'm not getting much money. Like, I have nothing, but I'm poor. But I have everything because I have God and I have prayer. When you have prayer and God in your life, you want for nothing. That's what I want to transmit to people. And I hope that I've inspired a few souls out there tonight. Praise be God. So let's finish on a song. Let's see what song we can get. Okay, let's see. We'll sing O Holy Night one more time. Let's see, hold on a second. It's Christmas. Why not sing a couple of Christmas songs? Praise you, God.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born, oh, night divine.
Praise you, Jesus.
Led by the light of faith serenely beaming, with glowing hearts by his cradle we stand.
Yes, we do.
So led by the light of stars sweetly gleaming, here come the wise men from Orient land. The King of Kings lay thus in lowly manger, in all our trials born to be our friend. He knows our need, to our weakness is no stranger. Behold your King before him lowly bent. King before him lowly bent.
Hallelujah.
Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease.
Come on, Jesus!
Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord, oh, praise his name for
Praise you, Jesus. Amen. I hope you all enjoyed the prayer meeting. I did. I was filled with joy tonight because God is real and he wants us to have a relationship and he wants us to come to know Jesus. That is the end game. God wants not one of us lost. He wants us all to develop a deep personal relationship with the Trinity. Get to know God, talk to him, tell him your fears, tell him your problems, ask him how he is, and just start off small. And every day you will come to know God, how amazing God is, how loving God is, and how he will not let one hair on your head be harmed, because he created you for brilliance. He created you to stand out, and he created you for a life of eternity. This world is passing, the next one is forever. And remember that. This world is fleeting. The next one is forever. So praise be Jesus. And may God bless you. May you have a happy, holy Advent. And may God bless you this evening and the rest of your life and all your families. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless. See you soon.